Welcome everybody to this afternoon's webinar session. As Jennifer said, we've been giving some webinars over the past weeks and months now. And I've introduced myself using this slide a number of times, just giving you my industry background. But what I haven't done is giving you my pre-industry background. And in the lead up to this and some of the ads going out on LinkedIn, I recorded a video asking what does genetics and biological sciences have to do with the capillary pressure? Well, my background is not in petroleum industry. I did genetics at university. And biological sciences or biomedical sciences. But what that gave me was quite an in-depth look into laboratory processes, laboratory test design and control, laboratory reporting. And at the start of my career, I saw it as a disadvantage, not having the petroleum background. But as I've gone on in my career, I've seen the advantage of the laboratory background and laboratory study as being key to development in my career. And so I thought it was good to would be good to look at some of those things that I've discovered over the years or have worked on. We need to switch into the actual PowerPoint. We had some difficulties earlier with some of the animations or GIFs that weren't working. Hopefully those will work this time. Just to also give you a little bit of information, if you don't know about Premier Oilfield Group or Premier Corex, it's a group of laboratories globally. We've been around as this particular group since 2016, but Premier Corex has been around since 1975. Performing core analysis since then, and particularly in conventional special core analysis and formation damage, as well as reservoir geology. We have a very wide range of different services that we can apply. And my particular remit is to look at things like conventional core analysis, special core analysis, and EOR, or enhanced oil recovery. So these are some of the specialities that we can perform. The services that we provide. So today, what I'll look at is some general thoughts. I'll then look at what I would recommend as pre-calculations of expected results, and looking at a couple of different ways of doing that, as well as quality control. I'll then look at method sensitivity, and how to control uncertainties a little, and what to do with nonsensical data, because there are always outliers. And how do we determine what's unphysical, what's experimental, errors, etc. And then a couple of examples of some data learnings. So starting with some general thoughts, I have always had the opinion in science that we are accumulating knowledge. We never finish accumulating knowledge. If we live in infinite space with infinite data, there is no way that we can ever acquire the whole of that data. And as we go through our lives, as we learn things, we realize that it changes the way that we've looked on things in the past. So we always have to be open. And I like this phrase, the mind is like a parachute. It doesn't work unless it's open. And scientific thought, scientific principles are the same. We always need to be open that new technology, new revelations could change the way and change our perception of the way that we've been doing things so far. And this is another cartoon I love about understanding. The science is a continual pursuit for understanding. It's called reading. It's how people install new software into their brain. I've often found in earlier life it's difficult to learn by reading. That has become easier for me over time as I've read more and more, as I've written more and more papers. But still, I find it's far better to learn by doing things as well as reading. It's this continual pursuit for knowledge or understanding. And just as a very quick intro into looking at, because we're going to start looking at data and data interpretations, one of my favorite quotes is by Einstein: a theory is something nobody believes except the person who made it. An experiment is something everybody believes except the person who made it. There are always errors and uncertainties when we look at things. Each of us has our own experience and a different way of looking at things. And so we all have different interpretations. We could all see the same image and have a different way of seeing it. And I use this image here as an example. This is a photo I took of a rock surface. And I want you to concentrate on this particular image here. Now we're going to use a pole. And Jennifer's going to bring up the pole just now. And within that pole, there are four questions. How do you see that particular image? Is it raised coming out of the image, or is it indented going into the image? Or maybe you can see both ways. You can see it both raised and indented, depending on how you look at it, or none of the above. Or maybe you don't understand. So I'll leave a little bit of time for people to answer that. And when Jennifer thinks the sufficient numbers have answered, we'll show you the results. And this will just show you, I'm generally expecting somewhere around about 75 to 80% of people to see it one particular way, and 20, 25% of people see it a different way.
So I'll just share the results here now. Jules, got a bit of a mixed one here.
Okay. Yeah, so we're seeing here some people could see both ways, depending on you see it. That was different from this morning. But in general, most people, when I've done this, this morning was a classic case. 75% of people saw it indented, 25 people saw it raised. Now I'm going to switch and just overturn the image. And do the same thing. So this is that same feature, but just upside down. So the next, Jennifer, bring up the next poll. How do people now see it? Was it raised and is now indented, or it was indented and now raised? No change either way, or again, both indented or raised. And again, I'll leave a little bit of time for people to answer, and when Jennifer thinks that we've got enough people answered.
Yeah, I will just end and share results now, Jules.
Thank you. And so now we see, again, this is slightly different to the normal demographics I use, or I normally see quite often. So some people who had seen it switch. So that was, if you add up the first two, that's 25 and 45 roughly. And so about 70% of people saw it switch. I once had a question, well, which one is correct? And the answer is neither is correct, because this is a two-dimensional image. Our brain, because we look at things in three dimensions, sees three dimensions because of the shadowing. And this is all just a trick of the mind. Our mind is our brains are used to seeing things the way we see them. And it's one of the things that we always have to read data. It's very difficult to unsee things. So if you naturally see patterns in a series of data, when you see a similar series of data, you will naturally see that same pattern. And we need to be careful about how we're doing that. So it's always best when looking at data to have several people look at the same data. That would be something towards a peer review. The more people see it, the less subjective it potentially becomes. But whole societies, because of the way that we've been taught and the way we've learned, could see things in a particular way because that's the way they've been taught. And so we need to be careful when we're looking at data. In the ads, I said I would look at other things that seem unrelated. There's Sequoia redwoods, non-stick pans. And these are all things that looking at other scientific principles, looking around at what I see in nature, that have helped me to understand a little bit more of what we do. Coming from my background and looking at cell biology and particularly plant biology, and when I first came into the industry, understanding flow in reservoirs, I understood it by how I'd been taught flow in plants. And that's called the cohesion tension theory in plants. So what you have is water, is good at adhering to the sides of the capillary or the xylem, the capillary for transporting fluids in plants. Also has strong cohesion and cohesive properties. So it sticks well to itself. It wets surfaces well and sticks to those surfaces, and so is able to be transported in long columns in the plant. Now, the capillaries in a tree, the size of the capillaries would only really transport water up to about 1 meter. So how does water get to the top of a tree, which could be hundreds of meters? Well, every leaf has openings called stomata. You have evaporation from these stomata. Evaporation causes a vacuum effect just behind where it's evaporating within the cells around the stomata. And that vacuum pulls water up to the top of the tree. And that can be up to 100 megapascals of pressure. So we get this large evaporative tension. Because the water sticks, has strong cohesive, strong adhesive properties, it sticks to it together and remains as a strong column within the plant, and so it gets pulled up to the top of the trees. Now this is when I start thinking about the way that we clean and we dry samples, then we have to be careful sometimes of the way that we do that, because drying could could create these strong evaporative forces with associated strong surface tensions, which can be damaging to certain clay parts. I used this a few weeks back, or a couple of weeks ago, looking at wettability. Just on a non-stick pan, you can try this at home, where you place a droplet of oil onto your non-stick pan, it will spread out and wet the surface, whereas a droplet of water sits like a droplet non-wetting on the right here. Also, just thinking about that, looking at the difference of water in a glass cup or glass versus a plastic cup, where the plastic is non-wetting. The water in the glass, you will see a meniscus because the water gets pulled up the side of the glass because the glass is wetting. There is stronger adhesion to the glass than of water than to air, so it gets pulled up the side. And this is the basis of capillary pressure. And why in non-wetting cases, you would have this case on the left, and this meniscus and the water and a fluid being pulled up a capillary. In neutral, it would sit flat with no bending. And in non-wetting case, say like mercury in a glass tube, it would sit like the image on the right. I've also looked at raindrops on windows. And this basically just shows you how sad and a bit of a nerd I am. When you watch raindrops on windows and watch the patterns that they make and the flow paths, and you can see one continual flow path just to the right of the middle there, the water has made a path, and it will new droplets hit. If there's sufficient droplets continuously, it just keeps going down that one path, and it gave a little bit of understanding of flow within system. As water pushes through a porous media. Of course, none of these are perfect, but they're just simple ways of understanding what could be going on. And another one is bubbles in glasses. I've watched soda water or a Coke. When you watch those, how bubbles are formed in a liquid, where do they form? Well, they always form at surfaces. So you have this GIF here with the bubble just forming at a surface, and they actually form at where you have larger surface areas, so a change in surface area, and companies use these days. They create what's called nucleation points, so the gas nucleates on these larger surface areas, and they will create designs for the gas to form at the bottom of a glass and rise and create that form and that shape at the top of the glass in the froth or the bubbles at the top of the glass. What does that have to do with our system? Well, critical gas saturation. As just thinking through what's happening in the process of critical gas saturation in an oil reservoir where we drop below the saturation pressure, we begin to form gas. And gas will nucleate on surfaces. Where are the surfaces in your reservoir? Well, it's at the pore walls and the pore throats. So gas will nucleate and begin to form on the pore walls. The gas won't move yet. It has to grow. And as we decrease pressure more and more, the gas bubbles will increase in size, the volume increases, so saturation increases, but it's still not moving until they begin to coalesce, create larger bubbles, larger volumes of gas in one unit, and then it may be large enough to begin to move. And that would be critical gas saturation, when gas starts to move. So everything that we do, look around at other scientific fields to look at what's happening there, what advances are happening there, and what can we draw on that to bring into our industry. So then going on to pre-simulation. I believe this is important. The more I've gone through my career, the more that I will look at pre-calculating potential of what a test may produce. This is good for optimizing procedures and protocols. If I can calculate what type of pressure range I might observe, then I can optimize the type of equipment for measuring that. If I can calculate the sort of production volumes I might observe, I can then optimize the equipment to make sure I get more accurate production data. Or just simple validity checks and sense checks of what we're measuring. In one of the webinars, we looked at coring, and I was suggesting that there, rather than just using a standard rule of thumb of bringing a core to surface and the tripping rate that may cause gas to expand or may cause it to expand too quickly, that we should apply some simulations or calculations to that, obtain what we believe is the critical strength, the rock strength, tensile strength of our core, look at the impact of bringing that core to surface, the gas expansion, and with limited expansion, because it's trapped in a core with limited permeability, pressure begins to increase. If that pressure exceeds this critical strength, we may fracture the core, and that's going to potentially damage the core, maybe damage the tests that we would run on that core, make it impossible to run. or make it dangerous to run. So we want to optimize that process. So we can pre-calculate what the physical impacts might be. We can do the same for something like relative permeability. We can simulate in core flood simulators the properties of a particular core. We can assign what we believe might be a relative permeability if we've got a reasonable understanding, some capillary pressure, because the capillary pressure will impact saturation with some boundary effects. And we can just look at the impact of running this test at different flow rates. So this was one flow rate in the green. Purple is a new flow rate, and the blue is the final flow rate. Increasing flow rate changes my differential pressure, changes my production, changes the profile and the impact of capillary pressure on that sample, and I may get different results. And so I can optimize my test using these. I can also look at quality control. Quality control should be done continuously through the test. Shouldn't be left to the end. We quality control by a number of different cross-plotting permeability versus porosity, permeability versus other permeability data, etc., saturations versus pressures. And we can then look at outliers. So if I have my routine set of data and I overlay my scale set of data, it's quite clear that this sample is an outlier. And that sample was then an outlier in every stage of the test. And so it begs the question, well, should I have run that test? It's not representative of the rest of the data. And so it begins to be a quality control. If we had controlled it at this stage, when I say we, I don't mean we. In the lab, this is something that we look at doing. Controlling the quality, controlling data, doing these cross plots and checking whether these data are viable to take into the next stage of testing, so that we don't get to the end with a sample that shouldn't have been used. So then we have to consider method sensitivities. Each method we use could give different data. One of the simplest ones of looking at that, it would be pore volume, porosity. We can measure determine porosity by two different measurements, by three different methods. So we can either use pore volume and bulk volume together to get porosity, or we can measure grain volume and bulk volume to get porosity, or we can measure grain volume and pore volume. This is the order of accuracy or uncertainty within those measurements. Grain volume is the most accurate. And then bulk volume by mercury immersion is the next most accurate. And then as we go down this, we get less and less accuracy because some of these later ones, pore volume by helium expansion or bulk volume by caliper, they're dependent upon the shape of the core. And if we have an imperfect shaped core, then we will have imperfect results from them. And of course, the assumption is a perfect cylinder. And you never get a perfect cylinder. We get almost exactly perfect, but it's never perfect. And so there will be potential errors, particularly in this helium pore volume by injection, where any imperfections may be observed as additional pore volume, so additional porosity. And this is just one particular case that I was I could look at and see there was a six porosity, potentially up to a six porosity unit error between different methods. And what we should be doing is trying to reduce those errors in each of the methods. So quality control throughout to reduce the errors in our methodology. Another one of method sensitivity, which is very clear, is relative permeability. So if I were to run steady state, I would describe this region of my curve. If I were to run, it's designed to acquire a wide range of saturations. If I were to run unsteady state, I may only describe the end part of the curve. both the relative permeability to oil and relative permeability to water. Neither of these may achieve the true residual saturation. Quite often, flooding doesn't quite get there. They may get extremely close, but it's something that needs checking by another method, and that's where centrifuge relative permeability or centrifuge imbibition process, like a capillary pressure, can generally achieve much lower residuals close to the true residual saturation. And so what we should be doing is looking at different methods. Looking at, they should all basically overlay like they are doing here, but with different ranges of the curve. The other one that we should be doing as well is waiting for stability when we perform tests. In the lab, we leave time, we monitor the production, wait for stable conditions at each of those productions, and build then this is building a capillary pressure curve, drainage. But if a lab were to only use a specific time, say 8 or 12 hours, then this is the sort of data that they may obtain. And that leads to this green capillary pressure curve here. And the difference between these two curves is actually going to be a difference in your calculation of oil or gas in place. And the difference, there's, if we don't allow it to stabilize, then it will suggest that we have less hydrocarbon than are really there. And so we would be missing, in this particular case, 800,000 barrels of oil per square kilometer because of a difference in protocol of either running to a specific time or allowing the test to reach stability. So it's important to reach stability. So that's a bit about method sensitivity. So what about nonsensical data or data anomalies? Well, of course, sometimes it's very clear that data is just unphysical and cannot be true. So in this one, this is a porosity compaction factor. So in this, we're stressing the sample. As we stress the sample, of course, that squeezes the porosity. Porosity should reduce. So my porosity compaction factor should always be less than one. But this sample here is greater than one. And obviously that's unphysical. It's either a typo or it's a function of different methods. And so it requires us to look into those methods that have been used. And what I'm seeing here as well is differences in other properties. So some of the samples were mounted, and those mounted samples appear to have different properties to the other samples. And so we begin to have to ask the question, well, is that real? Is it because they needed mounting because they were weaker and so had different properties than the rest? Or is this a function of the mounting itself? So we begin to ask these questions. And if we start to see outliers if we have no other information, then we're left with a big question. What is this second set of data here? Is that an error or is it an anomaly? Is there a physical reason for it? And so another webinar I gave a few weeks back was looking at the importance of metadata. So obtaining all the data, things, how it's been cleaned, the rock type, the mud system that was used, as much information as you can so that we can begin to plot these data against different metadata and see, well, these ones, they're a different rock type. So these are real data. Otherwise, we have to then begin to say, well, how do we interpret that? And when we get to interpretation, as I mentioned earlier, that's subjective. Another thing to be aware of when looking at data is look at what you expect. Quite often when we look at stress data, many companies are just asking for a single point at the start and a point at the end. But many of the data that we look at are curves, and you can't draw a curve between two points. It's always a straight line, and you have no idea of what's happening in between from one point to the next point. And the curve should go like this. And as we stress samples, which is one thing that we do in our labs to simulate the reservoir properties and the reservoir geomechanics of the system, then what could be happening here is some collapse event, poor collapse, that could be signify subsidence may happen. So it gives some indication of the need to be careful in our operations, particularly through, say, something like a depletion process where the stresses on our system are going to increase. So what we have to do is we have to eliminate unphysical data and question the meaning of other outliers. The way that we control our tests is also important. We have to perform tests so that we're not increasing uncertainty or increasing error in the method that we use to perform the test. And this is a set of data I looked at in the past, where this laboratory had run these gas permeability at different pressures, but with the same flow rate. And what was happening by controlling a constant flow rate, they were getting decreasing differential pressure at each rate. And in this particular sample, the differential pressure was getting so low that it was very close to the error limit of the equipment. And so what was happening in these last two points here, you can see that there's a trend in this direction at the start, but these last two points are off that trend because of increased error. So the better way to run this would be at constant differential pressure with increasing flow rate. Another one to control, and we can pre-calculate, this comes into pre-calculations of your test data, is in-situ saturation monitoring by X-rays or gamma rays. Radiation, we will do calibrations with a gas-filled or an oil-filled sample, and get one set of data. We then fill this sample with water, saturate it with water, and get another calibration at 100% water. And the when we're running our tests, the difference between these two calibration points becomes my saturation. But we should be keeping error down to less than 1% saturation. How do we do that? Well, the error in counts is the square root of the count, or the standard deviation. And in a standard Gaussian error, three standard deviations capture almost the entire error. 99.9% of the error is captured in three standard deviations. So in order to get that our error down in these measurements, we have to ensure that we have sufficient counting time to allow high count numbers, which reduces the overall error compared to those high numbers. And these are cases where, in this case, this is not this was not less than 1%. This was getting up to 10 saturation units. So this is that's 10 saturation units here at 0.1. So the error was not 1%. By measuring at longer times, longer counting times or higher counts, the purple data in the middle there is then that same sample, but just left longer. And that's one of the ways that we can pre-calculate data and change the test. Another thing that as we begin to look at different and more complex reservoirs these days, some of these are going into some things that are potentially unusual, and some things where we still have learning to go. And one of the big areas of that is in permeability and permeability relationships. The standard industry concept is that my gas permeability is greater than Klinkenberg, which has to be true. And that is a physical process. Says that my oil permeability is less than or equal to Klinkenberg, which is greater than or equal to my water permeability. and my water permeability is greater than my effective permeability. However, this relationship is sometimes observed and is becoming more and more often observed as we look at more marginal fields with higher clay content. So what we can sometimes observe is that my effective oil permeability may be greater than my water permeability. There are a number, and this is just showing you a case of that. There are a number of literature cases trying to explain what might be going on there. Some of those are about clay interactions, either swelling and migration of clays because of the interaction with the water. Some of it is about colloidal systems and creating gels, so my viscosity is somewhat unknown. Another paper was looking at geometry of our pore space and seeing that we could have micro or local turbulent effects happening, which increases the pressure in those around the turbulence and makes the system appear less permeable than it really should be. And that is happening more with brine, which seems to interact more with the clays. So there are a number of different theories of what may be going on, but nobody has really yet got to the bottom of what exactly is controlling this. And it could be that it's an amalgamation of all of these different impacts. There are things that we can do to try and test for this. So if anyone's seeing this problem, then we can look at the different experiments that might help us to understand what's actually happening in your particular reservoir with this impact. Another one is we have to be careful when we do three-phase systems. In three-phase, we are changing our interfacial tensions. The interfacial tension between gas oil is 26, water oil is on average 40, and gas water 72 in our laboratory fluids. So when we apply different forces, we have to account for these differences in IFT, because if we apply the force in a water oil system at 40 dynes per centimeter, but then move to a gas water system where the interfacial tension is 72, we have to reduce the force that we're actually applying, because it will be giving a higher actual force when these three fluids interact in the sample. And again, that comes to pre-calculation or pre-simulations of what we think is going to happen in our sample. And then this was just sometimes we think we understand the process, and then something might come along that makes us rethink. This was a silica oxide sample, so a diatomite reservoir. And these diatoms, silica oxide, these were placed into an oven. They were just never stabilizing. We've got up to over 50 days of drying here, and they're still decreasing. Now, at different points, silica gel was added in here. Then we realized silica gel is very similar to these actual samples. So these samples are prone to atmospheric changes, the atmospheric humidity. So we captured the humidity data that's here. This is atmospheric humidity. And what we see is that where we have peaks in humidity, we see an increase in the density or in the weight of the sample, because the sample is taking on the humidity from the atmosphere. What we did was vacuum the samples. And you don't see it here, but they then became very stable for several days under vacuum, despite what was happening with moisture. So again, it's a case of just understanding when we get different samples and different reservoirs that we're not used to, that we may have to consider different processes to get accurate data. So in conclusion, we need to pre-calculate or simulate our expected results. That helps us to understand a bit more. It helps us to quality control. It helps us to optimize our tests. We need to consider the whole data set. So we don't just look at one particular piece of data. We look at how that piece fits into the samples as a whole. Try and get as much metadata as you can as well to understand uncertain anomalies. Quality control continuously. Don't wait till the end. Then allow production to stabilize. Otherwise, errors and uncertainties could be built into our data. Consider using different methods and understanding the sensitivities. So particularly with something like relative permeability, look at the different methods. They should overlay, but they show different parts of the curve. And then finally, control the uncertainties. So design tests so that we're not increasing uncertainties as we go on in the test. So thank you for your attention. Thank you for joining us today, and we'll open it up to any questions people may have.
So Jules, as we just wait to see if there's any questions coming through, we actually received a couple prior to the session today. So if I can just pose them to you now, then you can maybe answer them for me. Hopefully we'll have the listeners on board as well. So the first one, how has electrical properties experiments morphed during your time?
There have been changes. So when I first started in the industry, there was no such thing as a continuous injection. So we've seen the advent of continuous injection or things like rapid RI. So performing electrical properties and seeing stability in as a function of saturation more quickly in electrical properties than is happening in a standard test where you perform it with capillary pressure. But these quick tests don't give you capillary pressure. And it gives you a good understanding of the electrical properties, but in some ways it's weaker, in some ways it's better. It depends whether you want a time-based data, quick data, or you're willing to wait for stability. There has been more of a move in certain laboratories to have a four-wire system. As opposed to a two-wire system. There is also a move to do, if you go back 30 years, almost everything was done in an ambient cell with batch samples onto an ambient cell. There's much more a move to do that in a individual cell. It's much easier, it's better quality control in an individual cell. But you can also then apply temperature, and you might use crude oil in there and have wettability change as you're doing the test. So the basics of the print and the principles haven't really changed, but the way the tests are performed have morphed over time to try and control uncertainties in those tests. There's one question coming in, which database you maintain data for these studies and anything related to EOR, as these properties highly influence different flooding experiments. Yes, and there are few databases out there. There may be some for petrophysical properties. There are very few for dynamic properties. Generally, what I've done, I've been consulting for the past 7 years, and what we would do there was build our own database based on the data that was provided to us. But there is no off-the-shelf as far as I'm aware, there's no off-the-shelf product that allows for the dynamic data and cross-correlation of those. It's something that we could help with in building something, if that was of interest. Another one, KO S sub Y is often greater than specific KW water wet. I'm not sure what the question is there. That just seems to be a point that's made. And I would say a lot of if you go back 10, 20 years, that would not have been the case. Today as well, probably in carbonate systems, that is probably not the case also. Quite often, what we see is when you get into clastics with clay content, that's when we begin to see that sort of relationship occurring.
Okay, perfect. And I think the other one regarding the database you've already answered, so that's fine. There's another one come up now, Jules. Yeah.
If the KW is higher than KG, what could be the reason? There are many different reasons. I would generally start looking into those particular tests. So you have to, first remeasure and see, is this happening? Is it just that particular reservoir that's happening for? Or is this a constant thing you're seeing over different wells, different rock types, different reservoirs? If it's that constant over different processes, then I would then begin to look at your equipment and begin to question some of the accuracy of how, or the procedures that are being used. That look at things like leaks in one of the systems. So it becomes quite a question. It's unusual, particularly against KG, because it could be if you're at very high permeable systems. The potential error in flowing gas through extremely permeable, and I'm talking over 3 or 5 darcies, water or an oil would provide you a better reading, a more measurable reading, because at that sort of flow rate, you're in gas, you have to flow at very high flow rates, and you will still only get a tiny pressure. And so you could be inducing turbulent effects, which if you're in a turbulent regime rather than linear, you will get a drop in the apparent permeability. And so the gas permeability might seem lower than the water permeability. So it really would depend on the permeability you're seeing, and the actual just digging into the different tests that you're doing. There's without seeing data and without seeing the test protocols and things, that's a difficult one to answer. There was an addition to that, was saying it was constant at a certain depth. It would depend on the actual data. I would need to look at the data and look at the systems being used. Well, I think that's all the questions I've seen so far. So thank you again for your attention this afternoon and for visiting us.